God, I'm on my knees again. God, I'm begging, please, again. I need you, Lord, I need you. Walking down these desert roads, water for my thirsty soul, I need you. Yes, God, I need you. Your forgiveness is like sweet, sweet honey on my lips. It's like the sound of a symphony to my ears. It's like holy water on my skin. Yeah.
Oh. Dead men walk enslaved to sin. I wanna know about being born again. I need you. Oh Lord, I need you. So take me to
I don't want to abuse your grace. God, I need it every day. It's the only thing that ever really makes me want to change.
I don't want to abuse your grace. God, I need it every day. It's the only thing that ever really makes me want to change. Yeah.
I don't want to abuse your grace. God, I need it every day. It's the only thing that ever really makes me want to change. I don't want to abuse your grace. God, I need it every day. It's the only thing that ever.
is crowned with glory now. The Savior knelt to wash our feet. Now at his feet we bow.
The one who wore our sin and shame, now robed in majesty, the radiance of perfect love, now shines for all.
Praise will rise. Morning, all.
Morning, guys. Hola to our family in Mexico. Hi, Brian.
Morning, Hannah.
I hope you guys are all having a wonderful weekend, enjoying the sun. Later on in the service, Nigel will be... what's the word?
Preaching,
that's the word. Yeah. Thanks, Brian. So Nigel will be preaching and there will be communion later on as well, if everybody can get prepared for that during the service. Get the bread and maybe not wine because it's a little bit early. But if you can get your fruit juice out of the cupboard, that'd be perfect. I, as you can see, I've got Brian with me today.
Morning.
Helping me out. Correcting my errors and mistakes.
No. You'll have to remind me to hold the microphone.
So what have we kind of got going on, Brian?
Well, shall I read out some of the notices this morning?
Yeah, go.
First of all, we've got, as we're Lister Hill as part of Horseless Churches Together, HCT, we're still looking for a rep from Lister Hill Church. If anybody would fancy sort of working, just making an appearance for a week, just maybe to try it out and see how it goes, really. And I'm sure Jill Woodman would value that support because she's acting chair for HCT this year.
Is she?
Yes.
Oh, I didn't know that. Yeah. Hi, Jill.
Hello, Jill.
So on from that as well... there seems to be a need for people to sign up for football. As you know, the Euros are here, and if anybody wants to kind of play football or that's spurred anybody on, then is it New Life Community Church are looking for people to play, and if you are interested, then please contact the office via kind of our website and things. Just give us an email and then we will get back to you with more information on that one.
I believe John Fairburn signed Kevin up for that, I believe.
I think so, I think actually. So, yeah, that'd be so exciting.
part of the other notices, I think I've gone a bit loud there. Part of the other notice is Rory's doing the Monday night, which is going into deeper relationship with God, which I've been doing for a few weeks, and I really value it, actually. It's really good.
Yeah.
It's quite challenging, but...
What's it kind of entail? What's...
It's a step program in sort of going into the deeper relationship with God. And there's certain stages and certain things you have to do and work through. Some of them are not too bad. Some are more challenging than others. It's maybe more of an in-depth freedom in Christ, really, I think.
Okay.
But yeah, it's very good. If anybody's interested, then...
get yourself signed up.
Yeah, with the office, or alternatively, give Rory a ring. I'm sure he'd be able to fill you in on more details. So yeah.
Yeah. I'm sure later on, Brian kind of be keen as up to the provisional kind of date for maybe church opening up, but at the moment. As we are online and things, there's one thing that we were kind of talking about just before the service, weren't we? I've been kind of going on YouTube every week and not realised that there is a button.
It's been a bit quiet.
Yeah, it has been really quiet, actually, very inactive. And I was like, oh my goodness, where is all my church family? There's usually a good morning from Kev.
Was this quiet because we were on YouTube rather than the...
Yeah,
Sunday
the website.
Service.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah,
I
didn't realise there was a lot of kind of interaction on the website and things,
right, yeah.
Like emojis and.
Yeah, all right.
Yeah.
Right.
But yeah, so I'm going to try
that. Like the waving.
Yeah.
Like the Mexican
hat. Oh, yeah. Raise the roof.
Another reference to the Mexicans there. Morning.
Morning. yeah, so. also, I think online there is kind of like a button that you can press that kind of brings you to, I think, just a prayer site with, I think it's a private chat with people that you can kind of request prayer from and things. So that can be pushed whenever, just right. and then we'll be praying for whatever you kind of request and things like that. And I think there's also a Bible app as well linked to that as well. So that's pretty cool.
Very good.
So I'll be checking that one out next time.
I think the next thing I was wanted to bring to the notices, which was everybody's really interested to hear about what's happening with reopening a church, which hopefully will be on the 27th of June. We're keeping one eye on what the government's saying and their stance over the next few days, really. So it's a matter of just seeing how things pan out, really.
Yeah.
And we'll try and keep the church informed, really. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay, perfect. So is that all the... the notices.
I think that's about it. Yeah. Do you want to get off to?
I think I'll get off. Are you okay
worship?
To open us up in prayer?
Yeah,
and things?
I can do
is
that. That's
that
fine.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Well, Hannah's just going. Just pray for the church this morning, the service. Father God, we just bring this morning service to you, Father, and we ask for your blessings and. Ask that you would bless the preaching and the worship, and for the people in the church, that this would be a connection with you, Father, and for people who may be watching from outside, may they be blessed by what is being said and giving glory to you. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you, Hannah.
Fullness of eternal promise, stirring in your sons and daughters, earth revealing heaven's wonders, Spirit come, what you spoke is now unfolding. Children shall behold it. Dreams awaken in this moment. Spirit come. Pour it out. Let your love run over. Here and now. Let your glory fill. Thank you.
Mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up till I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God.
And all my life you have been faithful.
Thank you, Nigel, for preparing the sermon for this morning. I just want to pray for you just now. Father, we just thank you for Nigel, and we ask that his words that he speaks this morning would go out, and they would have impact upon Lister Hill and the people watching right now. We ask for your blessings on this, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning. It's good to be able to be sharing God's word with you this morning. I'm going to be reading a little bit later on, partway through the sermon this morning. So let's get straight into what I believe is on God's heart for us today. Over the last few weeks, John and Johnny have been talking about disaster and trouble, and how, in particular, two people, Job and Ruth, faced those difficulties. They had choices to make. They could have been overwhelmed by what was happening around them, or they could pursue who God had called them to be. And we see, particularly with Ruth, that they chose to embrace the calling that God had placed upon their lives. Troublesome and hard circumstances are dividers. They divide people, and it creates two groups, those who overcome and those who give up. They can divide our lives. They can divide our lives to times before particularly troublesome events and time after. The difficulty with such major events is that they can have such an impact upon us, that they determine our identity and what we do. But God tells us that our identity is determined by who he says he has made us to be, the new creations that we are in him, and the significance of our calling and gifting, which flows out of the significance of who he is and the authority that he has. So within our new creation, our new life in Christ, God has given each of us an identity, a calling, a purpose, resources and abilities, which we call gifting. And his heart for us is that we steward this calling and gifting to fulfill his purposes. This morning, I believe God is wanting to talk to us about how we steward our calling and gifting in the face of life's tough circumstances. Will we face up, or will we give up? In the parable of the talents in Matthew chapter 25 and verses 14 to 28, what we see, an account that I'm sure that we all know very well, that the context of this passage in Matthew 25 is in the midst of Jesus teaching on what is going on before his second coming. So it's particularly relevant to the end times in which we find ourselves. It's about bringing in God's kingdom and being prepared for the return of Jesus. The three servants in this parable that Jesus was telling were given different gifts by the master, or at least different amounts of gift, and sent off to use them. Two of them do, and the third one doesn't. The two who did, who took those resources that were provided by their master, were commended and rewarded for their stewarding, whilst the third one was not. A significant point to make here is that the master provided all the resources that each servant required, and then he left them to get on with it. He did not micromanage what they were doing. He did not set someone over them with authority to manage what they were doing. Nor did he put systems in place to ensure they did something with those resources. He trusted them and let them get on. God has always made giving man freedom his highest priority. And when the freedom means making poor choices, he still values the freedom that he has given us. He gave it to Adam and Eve, and he gives it to us. Because his eternal plan is that we, as God's people, in partnership with him, partnering with the work that he has given us to do, that we should demonstrate to all creation, which the universe, which at the moment, the only life that we are aware of is here on earth. That might yet change, but at the moment that's the case. That we, together in partnership with God, can rule effectively and steward the way that God originally designed us to and gave us authority and permission to do. That's his plan, that his now that he has given that authority to his children rather than to the whole of mankind, and that we are to use the giftings and the calling that we have received to steward the world in which we live and to demonstrate that it is possible to do this when we partner with God. So let's have a look at particularly the one servant who didn't do anything and find out something of why he didn't do what he'd been asked to do. The first reason that he gives for not doing anything with his resources, with the talents that he's been given, was that his understanding of who the master was. He thought that the master was a hard man. Well, the master challenged his view and asked him that question and said, "Is that who I am?" Effectively saying that this is who you think I am, but that's not quite right. Maybe the servant in the past had been disciplined by the master for doing something wrong and had come to a wrong understanding of who he was. To be able to steward our calling and gifting well, we have to have a really good revelation and experience of who God is. The understanding of the one who loves us, cares for us, resources us, gives us freedom, and who promises to walk every step of our lives with us as we seek to walk in obedience with him. The second reason that the servant gives is that he was afraid. He had fear. Afraid of doing what he'd been commissioned to do by his master. As one who is afraid of heights, I know all too well what it is like to be paralyzed by fear, unable to move, unable to take the steps that you need to reach the goal that you've set before you. Fear is a very real experience for many people. And different people experience fear in different ways. And we process fear in different ways. In this case, the fear stopped the servant from using the gifts to fulfill his commission. 1 John chapter 4 talks about fear and love and how perfect or completed love casts out fear. Again, these verses indicate that where there is fear, there is a need to come closer to our Heavenly Father and to understand and experience more the truth and reality of who he is, that he is love. So fear, we can see from these verses, fear and an incomplete understanding of the master were the underlying reasons as to why this servant did not fulfill his commission. I'd like us to think about this a little bit further by looking at the Old Testament prophet Elijah. The prophet Elijah was a great man of God, used by God in some amazing ways, experienced God's divine provision when circumstances were pretty bleak, and also facing famine and opposition from those in authority. During Elijah's time as prophet, Ahab became king of Israel, and he was not a good king, and he did not always follow the ways of God. And in particular, he encouraged the people to worship other gods, Baal in particular. So Elijah went to Ahab and said that there would be no rain until he had said so, and left. And he couldn't be found in Israel for about 3.5 years, even though they looked for him everywhere. And Elijah came back to Ahab after that time and told Ahab to pull all the people of Israel together, to draw them together at Mount Carmel. Now, Mount Carmel is in the northwest of the country. It's near the Mediterranean coast. It's on about a level with Lake Galilee, so up north, but on the coast. And he called the people together. And then we have the incident in 1 Kings chapter 18, where Elijah challenged the people to repent and trust in God, and to worship God only rather than Baal. And he did this in the form of challenging the prophets of Baal to make a sacrifice and to call on their God to answer with fire. And when they couldn't do that, Elijah had a go, and God's response was to answer with that fire, and the fire came down and it consumed the sacrifice and the water that Elijah had placed on and around the altar and the altar itself. And the outcome of this challenge was that the people did repent and they came back to God, and they sought to have God as the one that they worshipped. After this event, the prophets of Baal were all brought together, and that they were slaughtered, they were killed, they were executed. Ahab, following this, went home and told his wife Jezebel, who was a Baal worshipper and supported the prophets of Baal. She was not a happy bunny. And she sent a message to Elijah to say that over the next 24 hours, she will find him and she will have him killed. And then we come to what happens in 1 Kings chapter 19. And that's what the passage I'm going to read for us this morning. So 1 Kings chapter 19, and beginning at verse 1. Now Ahab told Jezebel everything Elijah had done and how he had killed all the prophets with the sword. So Jezebel sent a messenger to Elijah to say, "May the gods deal with me, be it ever so severely, if by this time tomorrow I do not make your life like that of one of them." Elijah was afraid and ran for his life. When he came to Beersheba in Judah, he left his servant there, while he himself went a day's journey into the desert. He came to a broom tree, sat down under it, and prayed that he might die. "I have had enough, Lord," he said. "Take my life. I am no better than my ancestors." Then he lay down under the tree and fell asleep. All at once, an angel touched him and said, "Get up and eat." He looked around, and there by his head was a cake of bread baked over hot coals and a jar of water. He ate and drank and then lay down again. The angel of the Lord came back a second time and touched him and said, "Get up and eat, for the journey is too much for you." So he got up and ate and drank. Strengthened by that food, he travelled for 40 days and 40 nights until he reached Horeb, the mountain of God. There he went into a cave and spent the night. Then the word of the Lord came to him, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" He replied, "I have been very zealous for the Lord God Almighty. The Israelites have rejected your covenant, broken down your altars, and put your prophets to death with the sword. I am the only one left, and now they are trying to kill me too." The Lord said, go out and stand on the mountain in the presence of the Lord, for the Lord is about to pass by. Then a great and powerful wind tore the mountains apart and shattered the rocks before the Lord. But the Lord was not in the wind. After the wind, there was an earthquake, but the Lord was not in the earthquake. After the earthquake came a fire, but the Lord was not in the fire. And after the fire came a gentle whisper. When Elijah heard it, he pulled his cloak over his face and went out and stood at the mouth of the cave. Then a voice said to him, what are you doing here, Elijah? He replied, I have been very zealous for the Lord God Almighty. The Israelites have rejected your covenant, broken down your altars, and put your prophets to death with the sword. I am the only one left, and now they are trying to kill me too. The Lord said to him, go back the way you came, and go to the desert of Damascus, where, when you get there, anoint Hazael king over Aram. Also anoint Jehu, son of Nimshi, king over Israel, and anoint Elisha, son of Shaphat, from Abel Meholah, to succeed you as prophet. I'm going to leave it there. So Elijah has gone to Horeb. Elijah is fearful and runs off into the desert, where he prays to God that he might die. God, through an angel, then provides food and water for him. God already knew what was in Elijah's heart, that he was running away to Horeb, which is Mount Sinai, so in the southern Sinai Peninsula, where the covenant was given to God's people under Moses. And that was well away from Jezebel, a place where Elijah believed he could meet with God. And the provision that God made for him was supernatural. The bread and water, besides being supernatural in itself, in as much as that they appeared with an angel, was supernatural substance as well, because that food, that two lots of food and two lots of water, enabled him to walk for 40 days to get to Mount Horeb in the Sinai Peninsula. And when he gets to Horeb, God says to him, what are you doing here? I think that the conclusion you come to with this is that this was not God's will for Elijah. This is not where Elijah should have been to fulfill his calling and gifting. God did not want Elijah to come down to Horeb. And yet, God himself had provided the food and water to enable Elijah to get there. God still loved Elijah and took care of him and met his needs, even if he was in the wrong place at the wrong time. We cannot come to the conclusion that such provision, supernatural provision, is affirmation of being in the right place and doing the right thing. As God challenged his presence at the mountain, God has met Elijah's need, but he is also holding him accountable for his calling and gifting. The fear of Jezebel and what she might do to him, the fear of someone else's power over him, had taken root in his heart. And this fear had been allowed to overcome his calling and gifting. God then sends Elijah out of the cave onto the mountain to be in the presence of God. So that's what he does. And then he experiences the natural power of wind and earthquakes and fire. All natural events which had terrifying power, sufficient power to kill him. and yet God's presence was not in these events. They are natural events, not supernatural ones. Then comes a gentle whisper, the voice of God, the presence of God. And Elijah's response was to cover his face with his cloak. The presence of God, the supernatural, was in the voice. The voice went on to say again, "Elijah, why are you here?" To which Elijah responds again with all that he has done, what is in the past, and that he believed he was now the only prophet left. I believe that the writing between these very simple and very few words looks something like this. "Elijah, what are you doing here? I have not called you here. You have come out of fear. I have called you to be a prophet to my people, which you can't do whilst you're here. Why are you fearful of power that comes only from natural things, when you should only be fearful of the power which is supernatural? The calling you have from me is supernatural. The thing you are afraid of is only natural and is nowhere near as powerful as your supernatural calling." If we contrast this with the disciples after Pentecost, when they were told not to preach any more about Jesus, and how they prayed in accordance with their calling for greater boldness, the result of which was a shaking of the building that they were in and a fresh experience of the Holy Spirit. Those disciples were stewarding their calling and gifting. I think the writing between the lines here continues that Elijah is unable to let go of this fear, and his calling is effectively being brought to a conclusion by God, who instructs him to go and anoint Elisha as his successor. Following this encounter on Mount Horeb, Elijah doesn't really undertake any further significant ministry as God's prophet. This is not to say that God stopped loving Elijah or honouring him. He was one of two men who were taken into heaven without dying. He was one of two who represented the law and prophets on Mount of Transfiguration. Jesus acknowledged that his spirit of turning the people back to God would appear ahead of the coming of the Messiah, which it did in the form of John the Baptist. So God didn't stop honouring Elijah or accepting him, but God knew that in the freedom that Elijah had to allow his fear, the fear of the natural, to overcome his fear, as in his reverence and his revering of God, to overcome his calling and anointing, the effectiveness of Elijah's ministry was at an end. But God valued Elijah's freedom to steward his calling and gifting, such that when Elijah said he was too frightened, God gave him the freedom to give up. He gave him the freedom to be disobedient. Elijah expresses his belief that he is the only one left. By implication, he is isolated in his calling. He was mistaken in this belief, but that was his belief. He thought he was alone and that he acted alone. So what is on God's heart for us this morning in these illustrations that I've picked from Scripture? Jesus said in Matthew chapter 10 verse 28 that we should not be afraid of the natural, those who could kill the body but not the soul, but we should be afraid of him who can destroy both body and soul. or to reinterpret those words. Don't be afraid of the natural, but revere and hold as your highest priority the supernatural calling and gifting which God Himself has given you. When we're faced with devastating circumstances and huge difficulties, God desires that we understand the difference between the natural and the divine. Courage is not the absence of fear, but the willingness to overcome that fear and any other emotions which would be a barrier to our calling and gifting. Not to give up and run away, but to come to God's presence at the place where we are called to exercise our gifting and to hear His voice, which releases great power in us, a greater power in us than the world can throw at us. Hearing God's voice releases all the power and permission we need to express and fulfill our calling and gifting. When we find ourselves and our gifting opposed, and we are in a place where fear could take root in our hearts, we need to come into God's presence and ask Him for greater boldness. Then God will give us a fresh infilling of the Holy Spirit, a fresh experience of the supernatural, which overcomes the natural. He helps us to grasp and take hold again of the reality that our calling and gifting carries power and permission which cannot be overruled by any human authority. His heart for us is that we should not become isolated in our gifting, but connecting with those who have similar gifts to practice and develop and help secure the gifting in our lives. His heart is that we come to a greater revelation of who He is and what He is like. To pursue with all that we are the presence of God. To practice loving Him with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength. Or what the Bible calls wholeheartedness. God desires not that we don't have any fear, but that we overcome that fear with knowing the authority that He has placed in our lives, the power that He has placed in our lives, the anointing that He has placed on our lives. God's heart is for us to steward the gifting He has placed within us, that we would see His kingdom come. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank You that You have called us. We are Your children. Thank You that You have placed within each one of us Your presence through the Holy Spirit and have given us gifts. Gifts that are unique to us, but gifts that are there for Your purpose in these end times to bring the kingdom of heaven. Father, we acknowledge that we often have fear in our lives, and there are times that we are overcome by that and we give up. Father, we're sorry for that, and we ask this morning that You would help us to come into Your presence, to know the power that there is in our authority and our permission and our anointing to be the people that You've called us to be. Father, we ask that You would set that flame burning again. You would fan that flame in our lives, in our hearts, in our spirits, that we would pursue You and we would bring in Your kingdom through the calling, the gifting, the anointing that You have placed within us, because we have Your power and we have your permission. Holy Spirit, we invite you to come. Fill us again. Help us to experience the powerful presence and the very powerful voice of God. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you, Nigel. We're coming to communion now, and we're just going to do one more song before that. Thank you.
Just what to do.
We're just going to head into communion at this time of the service. We will just take time to examine ourselves and just prayerfully consider where we are with God and God's standing. Thank you. Hannah, I believe you've got a reading.
Yeah, I'll be reading from 1 Corinthians 11, 23, if you're wanting to read along at home. So, for I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night that he was betrayed, took the bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Therefore, whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of sinning against the body and blood of the Lord. A man ought to examine himself before he eats the bread and drinks from the cup. For anyone who eats and drinks without recognizing the body of the Lord eats and drinks judgment on himself.
Thank you, Anna. This is Jesus' body broken for you. Jesus' blood shed for you. Thank you for this meal, Jesus. Thank you for all you've done on that cross. Amen. Over to you, Hannah.
So just before we start kind of the next few songs, I kind of just wanted to give you a little bit of background. And when Nigel kind of told me what he was going to be preaching on and the giftings and things like that, I got a strong sense that I just kind of needed to touch on the parable of the fig tree. It's Luke 13, 6 to 9, just in case you're wanting to either read it or look over it later. But with that, it's kind of saying that the fig tree in this parable represents us. The gardener is God. The fig tree owner is us, the gardener is God, and the fig tree is the calling, the gifting, however you want to call it. And in this sense, I kind of wanted to say that the owner's getting very impatient, and he's saying, you know, I want to tear this down, and, you know, it's too much to handle, and this And in our lives, it can be fear or stress or feeling like we're not good enough or unworthy of our gifting. And we want to, you know, call it quits. We don't want to do it anymore. We don't feel worthy of it. And God's being the gardener saying, no, give me a little bit of time, give me a little bit of patience. And what I'm going to do for you is I'm going to sow the seed and I'm going to nurture your calling. And if you help me with that, then we get to grow it together. And I'll show you what I can do. Just very, very quickly, now we're recording. And, you know, I feel very inadequate at the moment. I don't feel like this is something that I not should be doing, but something that I feel very unworthy of, something that I'm very fearful of. And it feels like a lot of the time, you know, this week leading up to this service, it's been a really rough week. And I've just had to trust God and trust the calling that is worship, and it's the one thing that gets me through anything. So that's just what I kind of wanted to say, is just give God a little bit of patience, nurture your gift and your calling, and just know that he's behind it, and he won't give you anything that you can't handle. We're just going to go into the next few songs and
I surrender all. Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon
Thank you to the worship group. Thank you to Nigel as well. I'd also like to say thank you to Kevin and John for doing so much with the putting these services together. Oh, Hannah, back again. We just wanted to bless you this week. Father, we just pray blessings on church and the people who've been watching this morning, Father. I just pray that you would be with them, and that they would stay in contact with each other and recognise your hand on their lives, Father.
Amen.
Amen. Yeah.
Have a lovely week, guys, and we'll see you next week.
Yeah. Adios.
Adios.